Hi.
Hello.
So, you're a new actor now.
No.
You're like a first-time actor. It's like a whole...
Yeah, that's funny. Yeah, an overnight success after 30-some years.
It's been 30-some years and an amazing career, really.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Now you're. Do you feel like it's a rebirth or a new?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, why not? It is. It is. Look, I mean, I was slaving, you know, in the theater for years on end, and on TV and the little movies, you know. I mean, little movies and big movies, but little parts and you know, some. Some in most in Germany, in Austria, some in England, some in France.
You've been working in English since the beginning, pretty much.
Yeah.
I mean, you did Catherine Zeta-Jones' first movie, Catherine the Great.
I know. Oh, it's funny. Yeah. No, I was when I was very young, I was in a war movie with Robert Mitchum and Cord Jurgens and Richard Burton. I had a scene with Richard Burton, which was cut out from the movie, so I have no proof that it's true.
So did you want to become a Hollywood actor at that point? Was that the
Well, episode? No, I didn't. Yeah, of course I wanted to become a Hollywood actor, but I didn't know what it was. And I still really don't, you know, to this day. You know, I want to do the good stuff like everybody else. Yeah, if it happens in Hollywood, if I get it, I assume then I'm a Hollywood actor. I don't know.
Did you come to LA and make an effort to do that at some point?
I did at one point. I was about, I don't know, 22, something like that. And a friend of mine had arranged a meeting with Paul Kohner, who just, it happened so, knew my grandfather. And so, you know, he said the right thing to me. He said, you have to make up your mind. You want to pass through the background for the rest of your life yelling Heil Hitler. And, you know, he put it very bluntly, very directly, and very effectively, because I knew at that very moment, no, thank you, I don't want to. And, you know, so many people I know make the effort, which is... you know, to be admired, and still, in a way, a little naive, I find, you know, to come here and try, you know, to find a gap where they could fit through. I don't know, they, you know, they do what they could have done over there, and all right, the weather is nicer, yeah, that's true.
Well, Till Schweiger, who's in the movie, Inglorious, made a run at it, and had a big career in Germany, and then kind of came over here and never found the... great opportunity.
Yeah, and he not a great one. He was doing all right. You know, I think there were a lot of other things with Till why he returned. But it needs to be said in all seriousness. You know, I mean, a part like my part in Inglorious Basterds, it would be very silly, very very silly to count on that.
Right.
You know, because it doesn't exist. And that it does, or did, or, you know, happen to me, just proves a point. That's the exception to the rule, you know, but that was it.
Yeah.
There are no more exceptions.
So do you know where Quentin saw you, that he was kept attached to you?
No, I don't want to know. You know, sometimes, I have no idea. You know, it's the German casting agent. I don't know what she showed him.
But didn't he actually work on the script for you at some point? Didn't he kind of like, he hook into you as a guy?
No, the script was finished. The script was the script. You know, we did not change one letter. And I made it, you know, an important part of my preparation and my goal to not change a comma, you know. So I adhered to the text. You know, letter perfect.
And what was the first contact you had? What was the first time you did you were you put on tape the first time?
No, he doesn't do that. You know, that's another thing. You know, in a way, for Quentin, we all know this. You know, the maverick and the zany wild guy. You know, the enfant terrible. Well, he might be. You know, I'm sure all of that is true. Not for me. It might be true. It's probably part of the sum total.
Right.
But you know, and Quentin in his work is like almost traditionally old fashioned, immensely well behaved, immensely accommodating, polite and helpful, and you know, sometimes to the degree of being solicitous, and you know, he sort of goes out of his way to make you feel comfortable and right and wanted, appreciated, and this incredibly never-ending flow of energy that sort of pulls everybody along, so that you encounter that as you enter the room for the first time. And it's just him, you know. Sometimes you come to these castings where you have like a whole you know, legion of people who all have an opinion, and you can tell from the way they look at you, you know, that they have an opinion, and you know, terribly intimidating. And they, you know, what is it that they want to see? Mm-hmm. They put up gadgets everywhere, you know. I did a casting once. I didn't even know what the bloody part was. You know, they had two cameras, with, you know, very jazzy looking camera people. Mm-hmm. So, what for?
So after all these years, you kind of know in the room what's going on. Do you have a sense of that?
Well, with the person, well, maybe you don't, or maybe I didn't know what was going on. But you know, you participate in what's going on.
Right.
And you need to be allowed to participate. Otherwise, you know, you don't stand a chance. So Quentin opens it all up to you and plays with you. It's fantastically entertaining to do a casting with Quentin.
So how far into the character that you ended up doing on screen were you at that point when you did the audition?
Nowhere near it. But that was not the question. That's another thing, you know. Quentin gives you the whole script. Normally you get the sides, you get like three pages of something that you have not the foggiest idea what it's supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And with Quentin you can put it in the whole context, you know the whole script. So, you know, you get an idea, you know, what can you do with three pages of dialogue? You can kind of say it, you know. It was not just entertaining, it was really interesting to play with him.
So how did the two of you develop where you would go with this character?
Well, as we went along, we rehearsed, we talked a lot about it, and you know, nothing mysterious.
Was there a moment you found him, or was it just
No, that it doesn't work like that. You know, it's no eureka, because that would be actually, you know, the ringing of an alarm. If you had a eureka, I got it, now I can do it.
Right.
You know, I mean, at least the way I look at it, as you develop it as you do it, and the point of departure is your preparation, yes, but you know, then you can't get stuck on that. You know,
right.
It might develop into something else, or that's why the director is important.
So was the first scene that's in the movie the first scene you shot in that character?
Yep. The first day was the very first thing in the script. And it didn't stay like that.
Right.
But the chapters, you know, it's in five chapters, and the chapters were shot consecutively. But within the chapters, we kind of bounced around a bit. Not with the first one, because we really did that consecutively.
So how many days did you guys take doing that?
We did 5 days on location and 3 days in the studio. On that, well, you know, 8 days for what adds up to be, I don't know, what is it, 16, 17, 18 minutes. It's not so bad.
No, but is your theater training important in a scene like that? Because it's such a big scene.
Yeah, absolutely. Is the ceiling coming down?
Apparently 2012 is happening. Roland Emmerich is somewhere. I think it may be actually your movie doing that noise, but... Hopefully it'll pass. Anyway, being a theater actor and doing a scene that long.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, not just because it's that long. Yeah, that too. but also to, you know, to have done a whole play, and this is a play. You know, it's like a play. It has all the classical coordinates and parameters and ingredients of a play. You know, the unity of space. It all plays within this cabin. It's just the two characters, the main characters, and you don't have personnel, you know, right, entering and exiting, and the unity of time. The beginning of the scene is the beginning of the action, and you know, the unity of action. It does not go anywhere else. It stays within that. It was like a play, absolutely, and I'm sure it'll be shown on a theater sooner or later.
You mean actually?
I'm sure.
Wow.
It's a perfect one act play, uh-huh, and not really that short as right, such, you know.
So it would be like a scene for actors to do, or are we going to do Inglorious Basterds the musical? I always think Tarantino films would make a good musical someday.
Maybe he should do one. I agree. he should do a musical once.
Yeah. But your character over and over kind of is like the cat who corners the mouse. Whether you're in the theater or whether you're at the restaurant, it seems like your character is always finding a way to find that corner for somebody else.
Right,
to be
the
in.
Claws come out and the mouse goes up in the air and over there, but it's still, you know, squirming. Yeah.
So is it fun to play?
Fantastic fun, incredible. It's it's a bottomless pit. This whole script, but especially this part, you know. And it's kind of a pity, you know, one should do it again and, you know, now disregard what one has done and, you know, use everything that was needed to be left out in the first run. You know, like people, you know, I worked with a theater director who had done Hamlet 8 times. Mm-hmm. Just because
looking
he said, just because he said, every time I finish one production, I discover something new and something that I left out, so I have to do it again.
I always think that cinema is not appreciated enough that way. The theater, you know, everybody expects theater to be done over and over again, and the great shows at least, and that there's something new to find.
That's true.
And somehow on film, remakes are always looked down upon as a bad idea because the original is so beloved that there's nothing else that anybody could ever possibly say.
Well, but I mean, you're probably more knowledgeable than I am in film history. Is there one remake that was better than the original?
There have been a number over the years. I mean, they do happen, but it's usually, I mean, there's so many, now as we get to the point now that it's 100 years of film, that, you know, there are movies from the 30s and whatever that are beginning to be remade, but then they start talking about remaking, you know, movies from the 70s, and you're going, really?
Yeah.
You have to remake RoboCop?
Yeah.
Paul Verhoeven's still alive. It's like...
But maybe movies are more immediate, you know. Yeah. They're closer to the what's happening at that time, you know. But
Technology changes. Kids won't watch black and white. It's very strange.
Ah, that's not true.
Your kids away?
Oh, when my oldest daughter was about 6 years old, she said to me, you know what, I think a real movie is a movie that's black and white. Mm. And I know exactly what she meant, because, you know, it's still one further removed, one stage further. It becomes more apparent that it is an art. That, you know, that confusing thing with reality, and, you know, it's something that Quentin plays with, especially in this movie, you know, masterfully. You know, what is real, what isn't real, and what do you take as the reality? Mm-hmm. And there are, you know, strong hints in the images, you know. It's fantastically interesting if you want to approach that movie from that angle.
So you raised your daughter well. Clearly.
Thank you.
Interested in aesthetics and everything else.
Yeah.
Kids aren't always that way.
No, they are. They just need a little help with it. You know, a little nudging, gentle. You know, in order not to trigger resistance, mm-hmm. But they need introduction.
Yeah. I felt that way this year. There was a movie called Where the Wild Things Are from the Sendak book, and I think adults were freaked out by it in lieu of their kids. But the kids seemed to all be able to just relax and enjoy. You know, there's a lot of very angry and painful stuff.
I've seen it. I loved it.
It's a great movie, I think. But the adults kind of seemed freaked out by the idea that a kid would somehow not be able to handle it.
Well, yeah, because they can't handle it. Yeah. You know, I was completely torn when I watched it. You know, this whole dynamic between the wild things that's going on, and it's like a regular dysfunctional family, or a semi-functional family.
So you've gone on to make a remake of your own. Now you're doing Green Hornet. So is that fun to be in the machinery of Michel Gondry is not exactly
so
Hollywood.
Exactly. So I don't really know what is typical, but you know, as I said before, I don't really care. Mm-hmm. You know, the typical Hollywood is if we all agree that this is typical Hollywood. If we don't agree, then it isn't.
Right.
So you know, in this case, nobody agrees. Not even the executives. No, I'm serious. They are fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they come look because they're interested, but they never interfere. You know, and because they know that it's their capital really to let Gondry do what he does best, and what he does best is having quirky, and you know, far out ideas.
You figure they wouldn't really know what to do if they were going to interrupt him. Like, how do you fix Michelle? It's
if you
beyond anybody else's comprehension.
Well, exactly that. And if you don't want it, why hire him? So if you hire him, you better commit to it. And they are completely committed.
So for you, was it this character in the script, or was it the relationship with the director and the idea of working with him and playing with him?
Yeah, well, and you know, Seth Rogen is so good and so funny and so smart. It's a pleasure to be in you know, working with them, but you know, in their presence, because it's constantly going. And you know, you have to get up a little earlier and you know, be prepared to keep up.
You get to be funny?
But funny, I don't know, you know.
Did you think you were funny in this and in Inglorious Basterds?
There were funny moments, yeah, definitely. I wasn't trying to be funny.
You're just playing everything straight. And
that's the root of funny.
You just go right for, well, that's your character, so severe. No, but he's always got that kind of twinkle in his eye, even in his most dastardly moments.
You know, Jerry Lewis had to be so outrageous in order to be funny, because had he not been so outrageous, it wouldn't have been funny.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was playing funny. And playing funny isn't funny. Playing funny is repulsive and boring at best. You know, so Jerry Lewis had to, you know, give it another 10 turns, and then it became funny.
Right.
You know, look at Stan Laurel's face, you know, not to talk about Buster Keaton. You know, it is for them a deadly serious thing.
Mm-hmm.
And only then can it be funny. At least that's my personal point of view. You know, it really has to be deadly serious for it to be funny in the end.
So in this picture, did you have the experience of, did it change at all for you as the movie started being seen by people, or was your joy taken from the experience of actually making the movie, or both?
In the Green Hornet, you mean?
No, or Inglourious
Basterds. No, Inglourious Basterds, you know, it's a bit like the question, is Quentin an American filmmaker or an international filmmaker or a European filmmaker? He's neither.
Mm-hmm.
Quentin is Quentin. So this movie and this experience cannot be compared to anything. It would be extremely unfair.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are other qualities with other movies, you know, and to weigh one against the other, I don't know.
For you as an actor, is your joy of the work is your greatest, you know, experience of the work, the preparation, the work.
I misunderstood. Well, the greatest joy is really, the greatest joy would be if I could sit in the editing room and see, you know, if it's such a fantastic editor like Sally, you know, see how she put it together. But I'm just the actor. I can't be there, you know.
Do you watch dailies?
No.
ever? Or
never. Never.
From the beginning, you said that was a bad idea?
It's a bad idea for an actor to watch dailies. It's a bad idea for an actor to watch himself while he's still in the process of doing it. You know, I mean, that ties in a little bit with this thing about, you know, the eureka, I got it, now I understand, now I can do it. You know, it's a process. It's not like a churning out of prefabbed and preconceived elements. It's like a whole living process. I mean, at least to me it is. And to watch and suddenly alter the perspective 180 degrees from doing it in front of the camera to watching and evaluating it from behind the camera, it can really throw you. Either you're hypercritical, then you get depressed, or, you know, which is probably even the greater danger, you start to like it. So, I did that well, I could do that again, you know, and that's where the process is interrupted. And you should be able to maintain that flow.
So do you like the director whispering in your ear and giving you a lot of advice, or do you feel like you're...
If it's good advice, absolutely. I don't like to be messed with, you know. But sometimes, you know, the directors intend to mess with you in order to throw you off track completely because hope that they get something extraordinary. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, you know.
So the love that's been expressed for you in the process of the movie actually coming out now must be overwhelming.
It is. It really is. Because, I see that something that I did came together and to fruition. And, you know, that's how it should be. You do something and disregard any anticipation of a result. And all of a sudden you're faced with a result. I sat in Cannes at the screening, and that's when I saw the movie for the first time. And I was completely blown away.
Because of all the things that weren't your stuff, or?
No, just to see it. Something that was such an intense working process. And all of a sudden it was a movie. And I think that's really how it should be. You do not think of the result. You think of the work, how it is, what it is that you're doing, you know, and you do it. And then it's being put together, and then you have the result.
So was this always your attitude about the work? Were you different?
Well, it was always my hope that one day I could do it that way, and there I did it.
But I mean, when you were 23, were you more career obsessed, or were you?
Yeah, well, that's normal. You know, has something to do with the testosterone, I think, or I don't know.
So did you grow into a more philosophical perspective?
Definitely. You know, you get hit over the head a few times, and you better become more philosophical.
And you must feel that your work is getting better with age?
Yes, of course.
Because not always, of course, you know, in this town, it's always like...
Look at the who are the really great actors? Great. I'm not saying, you know, good or fascinating or exciting. Great. It's the old guys.
So who do you, are there particular people who you love above others?
I have an idea about you know that good actor, bad actor thing, that I disagree with that anyway, because I think given the chance and the opportunity, almost everybody can be a great actor, a good actor. Yes, some can stretch their imagination a little further, and therefore they can sort of cover more territory. That's true. and some are more flexible than others, and some are smarter than others, or you know, make more interesting choices. But in general, they too need an opportunity. Mm-hmm. You know, you can have the greatest actor, most talented actor, if he never gets the right part, you will never know. Mm-hmm. So, you know, is he a bad actor because of that? No,
right.
He isn't. You know, someone gets one great part after another, he's a great actor. Well, maybe he's not even that talented,
right.
You know. Is he a fantastic, or is he a good actor? Maybe not. So it's very iffy to say, oh, he's a good actor, he's a bad actor. In that, he was good. In that, he was bad. And then you can go on, you know, good, what's bad. So do I have someone who I love more than, it all depends on the part.
So it is an amalgamation of everything, it's not just.
Yeah.
And is there a theater to film variation there? I mean, is the muscle group very different for you doing one and the other? And is it a talent?
That's a very good way of putting it, to tell you the truth. It's a different muscle group, but it's the same person. Mm-hmm. It's not, you know, it's not that. Theater actors usually like to get into movies, you know, and movie actors like to raise their profile by doing theater, you know. So, I don't know. I've done both for a long time. I don't think it's all that different. They're different muscle groups,
right.
Yeah. Well, you would use different muscle groups for riding a bike or for ice skating.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of, but you're still trying to keep the balance.
Yeah. It was exciting to see Chris Plummer still at almost 80 years old doing, you know, 5 movies this year and theater and, you know, keeping it all going at the same time.
Well, one mustn't forget to, you know, for some people there, it has addictive quality. You know, they need it. It's like any other addiction. I don't know. I'm sure it can be treated.
We'll have to get a shot for it. Worse than the swine flu. So now we're going into the award season. You've gotten already one big award from Cannes. But is this whole prospect exciting, or is just being, I mean, obviously it's complimentary and we know you'll appreciate it if nominated and so forth and if you win, but is it gravy? Is it another element of the experience? What is it for you?
Well, I don't really know what it is for me. I'm very skeptical and I don't want to jump ahead of myself or of anybody else. So we'll see. I'm so flattered and by the recognition and appreciation that comes my way, that it's almost, I don't know, I see it as one big pink cloud that sort of, comes over me and I'm stuck in the middle. And I don't even see the individual awards, nominations, all that. You know, it's just the excitement that and I'm overwhelmed is the right word. It's fantastic. It really is fantastic. It's almost unreal. And I do check once in a while whether my feet are still touching the ground. And you know what? They're not.
And does your family try to pull you down from the cloud and make sure you're still
grounded? Yeah. They can do that.
You got that.
Yeah.
And you still go to work every day.
Yeah, well, and on top of that, well, that kind of, you know, lifts me up another inch.
So it just gets better.
Incredible.